sheep is gone, my heart is full of sorrow. I can't believe how much I've let you down. I dread the pain that waits for me tomorrow. Reveals my broken dreams scattered on the ground. Please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you till my dying day. Help others find a way. I'm at your mercy. Please forgive me. I can't believe the God of earth and glory. Take the time to care for one like me. But I read in the Bible that old story, how he pled for my forgiveness while he was dying on a tree. Please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you till my dying day. Help others find a way. I'm at your mercy. Need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Please forgive me.
I became a work of art. I'm not picture perfect, just ordinary clay. And I still feel the master's brush on my life from day to day. On display, and on a hill of condemnation is where my picture starts. When he painted me with Calvary's blood, I became a work of art. Oh, I'm
danger. And that feeling to which I go, I'm going there to see my mama. I'm going there no more to roam. I'm just going over Jordan. I'm just going over home. I know dark clouds will gather around me. I know my way is rough and steep. A beautiful feels like right before me, where God's redeemed their vigil scheme. So I'm going there to see my father. I'm going over Jordan. Yeah, I'm just going over home. Yes, I'm going there to see my Savior. He said he'd meet me when I come. I'm just a going over Jordan. I'm just going over home.
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eyes. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no more pain, no more parting over there. Then forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand glorious day that will be.
Who could ever down your life on me, cleansing me, refreshing me with life abundantly. River full of life, I'll go where you lead. I will trust in you. I will trust in you, my God.
There is a fountain.
Welcome you to Hickox Baptist Church this morning. Lauren, if you will, how about open us in prayer this morning? Amen. On our calendar here, we got a church conference following the evening service tonight. On next Sunday, it's Father's Day. We're going to have donuts with Dad at 9:45. And then we're going to have baptism during the morning service. And we're not going to have an evening service. And it's been asked that granddads bring your grandkids, daddies bring your youngins, and have them go over there and have donuts with you, partake in that. On the 17th, we have ladies quitting at 10 a.m. On June the 19th, the youth will be having their June birthday celebration in the social hall. And on June the 27th, this one's kind of odd for me, going to be having a bridal shower for Kaylee Blocker and Riley Johns, my son. I guess I hadn't really had to say that out loud yet. But it's on the 27th at 7 p.m. in the social hall. It says they are registered at Amazon and Walmart. And there's a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board for help with food for the shower. I was just talking to Miss Ruby's sister, Miss Alice, and she said that there was a wedding in my future, There is, but I did not realize it's just getting closer. But anyway. Also, the kindergarten through the fifth grade will be going bowling Saturday, June the 15th at Strike Zone. Please sign your child up on the sheet on the bulletin board if they plan to participate in that. I'm going to give you a few stats now from the VBS last week, like baseball stats. I'm going to hook y'all up right here. For attendance on Sunday, last Sunday night, there was 119 kids and workers here. On Monday, there was 124. Tuesday, 113. Wednesday, 110. And Thursday, they kind of ballparking Thursday. They saying around 120 to 140. I don't know. Got off a little bit there. But the total offering that the kids brought for VBS was 284.24. And if I ain't mistaken, the girls beat the boys bad, didn't they?
Yeah.
Yeah, the girls, that's always a competition, the girls and the boys, what they're offering. But as a note, it says, we would like to thank all the workers and the church for always supporting our children and youth. And maybe we don't realize who all is touched by Bible school, but there's a lot of kids come to this, and yeah, they get to dance and they get to play, and if y'all get a chance, y'all ask Miss Olive about slip and slide kickball. But I'm just saying, I saw her take a nasty spill. But anyway, the kids get a lesson every night, so. There's a lot of Bible going on here too, but they always seem to enjoy it. But we do want to thank everybody that participated in that, and thank the church for always supporting. There was 70 in Sunday school this morning, and we thank you for being here.
Good morning, church family. Would you stand with us this morning as we enter into worship? There is a river whose streams make glad the city of our God. Amen.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of our God.
This is the day.
is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Down at the cross where my Savior died, and with the cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Lost
my sin. Oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul.
And Lord, haste the day.
Good morning to everyone. I hope you can answer that question right there. Is it well with your soul? And it's talking about your spiritual situation. We all got physical ailments, but having a spiritual wellness check, you do that between yourself and the Lord and by the reading and the teaching of the Word of God. This morning, I draw back to a passage of scripture not long ago. I believe I preached, and I really tried to read away from it two or three different times. And the further I got, the closer I got pushed back to these very same scriptures. So, not making excuses, but here it goes. John chapter 5. We're going to speak about the pool of Bethesda. There was a man there that was in a bad situation. In today's times, we would say that they were handicapped or disabled or the terms there, but they called them impotent folks in those days. They were he was not could do much for himself, but there was a place there in Bethesda where people gathered of that nature, and at this pool at certain times, an angel would come down and stir the waters. You know, you think about that, there really was only two angels left, figuring of archangels that were left, and so it had to be a derivative of one of those, maybe one of those angels under one of those guys, whether it be Gabriel or Michael, whichever one it was, that would come down, leaning toward Michael, because Michael was not the angel of announcements like Gabriel. I can't wait to hear from Gabriel, because the next sound that he gives is us going home. And I think it'll be a awesome thing. But nevertheless, the waters would be stirred. I want to read a passage of scripture, but this morning, and thinking about it, I really want to start with my focus on this man's situation that's in the flesh and in the spirit. So I want to look at it from that aspect. If you would stand with me, we want to read this little short story before we get into the message. And it says this in verse 1 of chapter 5. It says, after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these laid a great multitude of important folks, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity 38 years. I would say probably all of his life. We don't know how old he was, but I'd like to say it was probably all of his life. Let's pray. Father, today as we come to you, and we're so thankful, God, that you are with us. God, and I'm so glad because my soul is well because I'm your child. God, and whatever come my way, whatever may happen, Lord, in this life, God, everything is well with my soul. It has got a permanent home with you because I asked you to come into my heart and you saved me. That which you did and performed on the cross, Father, lasted even into now, and God, it'll last throughout eternity. God, be with us this morning. Let us hear a word from you, God, the thoughts that you've put on my heart and the reasoning there is, that we may reason within ourselves, Lord, to find where we stand, Lord, if you should come today. God, be with us now. And all God's people said, amen. Thinking about Bethesda, you know, everything in the Bible, especially in those Hebrew and Greek names, that even kids, people's names in the Bible has a meaning based on what it says. And Bethesda in the aromatic form almost means the same thing, but it has two of those. And one of them is the house of mercy, and then the other one is the house of grace. And not bad meanings whatsoever. When you look at that, you can kind of see. And in your mind, you're starting to draw a picture of this pool. Now, don't visualize it as a concrete pool. It was a hole of water, a swimming hole, if you would. I don't know, back when I was younger, we had a swimming hole we went to. It was called the Johnny Hole, and it wasn't nothing but a bar pit. Y'all know where the Johnny Hole's at? Y'all been swimming in the Johnny Hole? And they closed it down after they went. But anyway, we had a common swimming hole. But the unique thing about this particular one in Bethesda had great meaning. They're gathered around there. They were five porches. Now, there's no real significance about the five porches, but it kind of gives you a picture maybe of a pentagon-shaped deal. But basically, it was there for shade and protection, whether it be cold, rain, or hot, or whatever it may be. But it said at Solomon's porch, having Solomon's there, Bethesda pool, having five porches. So there's real no significance there. But when you gleam a little bit different and you think on the Hebrew side of this thing, it represents, it says, the meaning of it could be in the Hebrew is a place of overflowing water. a place of overflowing water. I wouldn't necessarily say that the pool overflowed with water there, but I think the spiritual meaning is there was a place there that was overflowing with blessings. Overflowing with blessings. If you were one of those that got a chance to get in there when the water was stirred by the angel of God to come down there, it would certainly mean to you that there was an overflowing of blessings over this overflowing of water when the angel stirred this particular thing, and it was great. One other unique thing I think you would enjoy about where this thing was at. The Bible strictly says, and the description is so great because it all has a purpose. It all has a physical purpose, and it has a spiritual purpose. And I grab a hold of things like that sometimes. If I can see the physical, I know God's got a spiritual something that goes along with that. And I look at that, and the Bible says that this thing was located near the sheep's gate. The sheep's gate. You got to figure about what the sheep gate is. Now, it says sheep market here, translated actually means the sheep gate. But now there was a marketplace outside of that where they brought all the animals to for market. That was a marketplace, not at the sheep's gate. But what was so unique about the sheep's gate and the pool of Bethesda being right there in the general location, it lay between the gate, Bethesda pool, and then the temple. That's kind of how this picture would line up. I mean, it's getting better all the time. How much better can it get? But here's what came through that gate. Now, you had the marketplace, and at the marketplaces where people would sell animals for those that didn't have any to bring for a sacrifice, or they would sell them to other sheep herders, or they would bring them in for whatever reason. But what came through that gate, the sheep's gate, there at the very entrance of the back part of Jerusalem, were sheep that were bought for people to offer as sacrificial lambs. That's what came through that gate. Now, that's just, to me, that became mind-boggling when I read about that. And I said, you know what, there's got to be something more to this. There's got to be something more to this. That only thing that would come through that gate, because the way it was located, it would come in the back way and come in only with the sheep that were designated for a sacrifice, would come into there and funnel down to the temple courtyard. And in the courtyard there, where the priest would pick it up from there and offer sacrifices for the family of who that was. It was just a sight and the way they done those things. And how ironic it is that there was a group of people there that had all sorts of diseases. Had all sorts of handicaps and different things. And the Bible describes them, as I had read those here for you, basically it said it was impotent folks there. The impotent folks, that really means crippled people, were there. But it names three of them out. And the first one that I want to talk to you about is people that were halt. I thought about that and dug around in that thing. Well, what is a halt person? Well, in the Hebrew, it talks more or less that halt people had some infirmity with their hands and in their feet. So they were crippled in their hands and their feet. Some of us here today, we came in and maybe limping or had something wrong with a knee or hand or a foot or something like that. So we can kind of relate to that. But that's the kind of folks there. Those folks were not able to perform in normal lifestyle, but doing something wrong with their hands and their feet. Now, there was also mentioned there was people there that was blind and could not see. Unlike what we have today, certain organizations would aid people with blindness, or family members or different ones that were blind. But it was a sad thing to walk by this place and see the mangled up hands and feet of people and see the blind folks that were there. Could you imagine being one of those waiting on the angel of the Lord to come down and you can't find your way to get in the pool? It'd be amazing. The way I thought about it, no redneck term, I'd just get in there and wait on the Lord. Ain't nobody going to beat me in there because I just get in there. But I don't think that was the rules of the game at that time. But nevertheless, I would try to make a way. And then there's another one that it mentioned, withered. Withered. Now, yeah, that pretty much speaks for itself. The definition of that is pretty much the same as the English definition. But what it is, it finds someone who is malnutrition, who couldn't either get the food or their body was just withering away. There was not a lot of hope for these people. They were just there and shrinking up like a raisin and just going away. You know, we see those all, especially age. I don't know about y'all, but, you know, when you're young and all like that, and then, you know, you get to my age around 39 and maybe a little older. Some of y'all are with me today. But there's things begin to happen. It's called the prune effect. You know, either you stay fat and keep that skin stretched out, or you start withering away and then have all these wrinkles. Flabby arms, flabby this. My wife likes to play with my turkey. I don't know why. We'd be riding down the road. She'd just reach over there and grab me by the goozle and go, tick-a-tick-a-tick-a-tick. I dare not do her that in anywhere. But it's something that happens over a period of time. But what we see these people here, there was something physically wrong. And they go there and they're basically just withering away. Things is not good for those there. But to me, I just can't get my mind off of the fact that where they were located for this to happen. All these sacrificial animals walking by to pay for sin debts or cover sin debts based on the Mosaic laws in those days to... the thing that would happen and people would do those things and everybody would walk by there and the only hope that these people had wasn't nothing to do with those sacrifices right there because they were already designated for somebody. So it wasn't helping them out none. They were still waiting on the angel of the Lord to dip down and stir the waters and someone, one person would get a miracle. It's just... It was amazing. I can't explain why God chose to do that, you know, but in the life that we have down here, I kind of see it. There's people right now on the worldly side betting on that one hope that's out there for them, betting on that one thing, and they leave Jesus out of the whole mixture, man. You don't have to bet on that. You can know that you know that you know that you're born again. You know that when you leave here, you can go home to be with the Lord. There's no guess in it whatsoever. The Bible says if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. That's just the way it is, and I believe that till the day I die. I said, well, brother, if you're wrong, well, I spent a whole life enjoying myself trying to please a king that I never laid eyes on. But if I'm right about that, I wake up one morning in a place called heaven where the streets are gold and the gates are pearl and the walls will be of jasper and where I won't have to work anymore. Wouldn't that be great? Because I won't know how to act. I think that's just part of life. But we see all these things happening. But I want to go back to the story for just a minute. Where I quit reading, I want to begin reading again. Verse 6. I'm going to go back at the 5. And a certain man, and this is about the story, this one person is there, which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie, he knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, wilt thou be made whole? In other words, the question is, do you want to be healthy? Do you want all this to go away? Now, you know, I want to start tracking this spiritual thing that come to my heart and come to my mind. When you think about this, what chance was it that Jesus would come by? What chance? How did Jesus get there? Well, if you study even on further in this chapter and the next chapter, we actually find out that Jesus came through a sheep gate. Why would he do that? Well, I'm just so excited about wanting to tell you about why he came through that. Because the only thing that comes through the sheep gate is the sacrificial lamb, which he was. Now, he's demonstrating that now to people who did not have a spiritual eye or a spiritual heart or anything like that whatsoever to go on to recognize that the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, has just walked through there some form of announcement to we Christians, we followers, that the King demonstrated he was the sacrificial lamb. And not only that, he didn't do like most lambs done. He walked up there to the pool of Bethesda, and there this man was, lame for 38 years, his whole life. Well, I want to look at it a little bit different now. He's physically in bad shape, I agree. But I think Jesus was there for more than just his physical need. Jesus, if you'll read on again in the next two chapters, the rest of this one and the next one, you will find that this man not only got healed of his infirmity, but God shows in his word that this man was spiritually whole as well. Now, I can tell you, King Jesus walks by that day, and he asked this question. He says, "Son, wilt thou be made whole? Do you want to be right? Do you want to be fixed?" You know, it's amazing. When I think of lost people in the world, and I was one of them, you know, I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner saved by grace, hallelujah. But there's people that are just sinners, have never been born again. Do you spiritually look at what you are laying around with? Look at your company, if you will. Those three things mentioned, spiritual, if you're hanging out with these guys, it's doom and damnation for those that are falling into this category spiritually. You blind, you cannot see, you don't want to accept Jesus as the Savior, therefore you're not whole. Not only that, you look at the other ones, other two things there, it just jumps out at you, you know, you're halt. You know, the problem is, without your hands and your feet, you can't do anything. I couldn't preach with my hands stuck in my pocket. If y'all don't know that, I couldn't just preach like this. I get into it. I reckon that's why I sweat so bad when I preach. But you think about that. So if you're that person and you're a sinner, not only are you blind to the things of God and the blessings that God can provide you, but now you're halt. And your feet are crippled. Your feet and hands are carrying you and causing you to do things in this life that bring more trouble on you than this life could pay. And it continues to do that until you render your hands and your feet over to Jesus Christ. Now, the other one is withered. Now, I want you to look at the picture of this lost person. He's in there with a bunch of crippled feet, crippled hand people, blind and cannot see. But now notice what happens here, and which is sad. You spend all these years, this man's 38 years old, without the contact of Jesus. And his life is a wreck on the physical side. His life is a wreck on the spiritual side because he never met this man named Jesus, never professed him as Savior and Lord. But what's happening is people today that are sinners that know to do better, that know that Christ is real, to know that that is the true way out, they are withering away in this life and getting weaker and weaker till one day you may not can make it to the altar. You may not can see your way. You may not have the strength because your new spiritual nutrition is drawn away from you. The spirit is not strong, knocking on your heart's door, man. It's a privilege to have an invitation given to you by the presence of the Holy Ghost of God that he would come down and offer himself to you, knock on your heart's door and say, "Come forth, thou halt and thou withered man." He says, "For I gave my life for you. Accept me and you shall be made whole." That's not what Jesus said this day, but this is what he meant in the other two scriptures. Not only did this man receive his strength, but not only did he die, he received eternal life through Jesus Christ. Because the Lamb that took away the sins of the world came through the sheepscape. My friend, if the Holy Spirit of God visits you this morning, he's just walking back through the sheep gate so that you'll recognize that he was the Lamb. John said this at the baptism of Jesus, "Behold the Lamb of God which taketh away the sins of the world." And my friend, I'll tell you that this morning, behold the Spirit of God, that in him he will take your sins away and get you out of this world. Man, what a situation. Looking at from this man's perspective. You know, it's amazing. This cat was among a lot of people. They said it was probably crowded, but that's why there was five porches there to get people in and out of the welter. And now this man finds himself under the shelter of Jesus. You know why? Because he gets to get up and leave that place. But it's ironic. So when Jesus said those things to him, and this is what happens when we give an invitation to people. You know, I don't know who God's dealing with all the time. You know, I don't know those things. But an invitation is this. Jesus' invitation to this man was, do you want to be right? Do you want to be made right? I mean, what would his answer be? What would your answer be? I mean, if you're hurting this morning, back, feet, knees, heads, and toes, which are all the above, you know, you can talk to some people just about, but do you want to be made whole? Your answer would be, yes. Yes, make me new. But, you know, Jesus don't always look at it from that side. He'd much rather you be made whole in the Spirit of God. Because he said, if some of these things out here, your eye, your lips, your nose, your feet or whatever, cause you to sin and stay away from God, it's much rather to go into heaven maimed than it is for you to not make it to heaven. So what we're looking at this morning is a heavy concentration on what do you say to God when he asks that question to you. Do you want to ask these people questions? Do you want to go to heaven? Yes. Are you going? I hope so. Oh, my goodness. I'm going. You hear me? I'm going, and I'm banking on that. I live like that. I don't worry about that. I don't let things of this life in the devil's mind tell me that. Now, he brings a lot of stuff with him. He throws a lot of blindness at me. He'll throw stuff that will wither my mental capacity. He'll do those kind of things. I mean, he's terrible about it. And he'll throw haughty things at you. A bad knee, a cancerous prostate. He'll do things like that in here. But what he cannot do, he cannot destroy the relationship between me and my Savior. And my friend today, if you're still hanging out with the haughty crowd, if you're still hanging out with the blind crowd, if you're still hanging out with the wither crowd, Jesus come to make your day. He come to make it better for you. That there's nothing more better than having peace inside of you, that if you was to die today, you would go to be with him. Man, whew, I'm about to slow down to get an amen and catch my breath. That's good stuff. But we see the situation of this man, and Jesus walks by, and he says, do you want to be made whole? Wilt thou be made whole? You know, definitely that question. You know, but the question to ask the lost person, do you want to get saved? That's the same thing. Do you want to be whole? Because if you're lost, then you're not whole. But if you're saved, you are made whole. Do you want to be saved? Do you want to be saved today? I believe in all honesty, if you got people out of the public and got them in a quiet room somewhere and they could write their answer out, I believe everybody would say, you know, I want to. I know that's what I need to do. You know, I sure would like to. But the problem is that they're not willing to commit themselves to the Savior. And that's a bad thing, because the Bible tells us that he didn't know if to do good or do the right thing, and don't do it. To him, it is a sin. Let me tell you, just thinking about it and agreeing with me that that's the thing to do does not make you saved. You have to ask Jesus to forgive your sins. You have to ask him to come into your heart. And it's just that easy. It's not just words. It's a feeling. It comes from the depths of your heart. You ain't got to say an audible word. Some people think it's got to be audible. It ain't got to be audible, my friend. You just down in your heart, you ask Jesus the only way you know how to come in your heart. The Bible says, thou shalt be saved. What more in this life? If you go out in misery on the physical side, what more in this life could you have? I can have peace and be miserable as tarnation on the flesh, but I can be happy in the Lord. I can have peace and joy knowing that even through this life, you know, if it happens that way, he says, I'm going to tell you, I still got peace because I know the outcome. But Jesus asked him that question. The impotent man answered him. He said, sir, notice this. Here's some of the problems with people today. He says, sir, I have no man, no man. Let me tell you, you don't need to trust in a man. Don't trust in me. Trust in the one who sent me. Trust in the word who gives me the word, that reads the word. Trust him. You know, there's something about that. You said, you know, I hear it all the time. He said, preacher, I wore that down there, got me good. That boy, that was that. I, you know, and that, good. It wasn't me. It was him. I don't mind you telling me, boy, that got on my toes. Boy, you know, I missed a lot of you about that far because I was aiming to your heart. Because your heart is what functions the whole body. And when the heart changes, this man not only walked again, but he had a heart transplant. And I'll tell you, my friend, you won't find a crippled man in heaven, but you'll find, you can ask and see, can I find a crippled man that was laying by the pool of Bethesda? I know he ain't crippled in hell. You couldn't pick him out of the crowd in heaven because he won't be crippled anymore. That's wonderful, right? But now, he had a change in his heart. And Jesus said to the crippled man, says, I don't have nobody. Listen, if you're waiting on a person in this world to come and drag your behind down somewhere to your knees and do like that, it will not work. You hear me? It will not work. You got to want it inside. I'll tell you what, if you don't think that God hears from the prison bars of sin in this life, what do you think what happened to Paul and Silas when they were thrown in jail? And at midnight they began to sing and they began to pray and all like that, and an earthquake came, and that's what can happen in your life. I don't care how big or small you are. Earthquake's pretty good size. He can bust those rocks of sin around your hard heart and get where it's tender and make a difference in your life. Samson there was blinding and grinding and all down at the wheel because he lay with a woman and gave out his covenant relationship with God, and they had him down there, and the Philistines were doing all that. But somewhere, walking many times around and around, grinding. Oh, Samson reached down. Some people say, well, his hair grew back. No, his faith grew back. He got back in touch with God. He asked him many times to forgive him and to set him free, and he only did it for one time, that he could go up and kill more Philistines than one gathered than he did the whole time. Listen, while he was in the sin of bondage, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego got thrown into the fiery furnace. They prayed before they went. They got right before they went, and they come out as healthier than they was when they fell in the hole. Daniel got thrown into the lion's den. He went amongst a bunch of hungry lions, and the Bible says that when King Nebuchadnezzar asked him what happened down there, he says, my God, shut the light in the mouth of these hungry lions, and there's no hurt on me. He says, oh, King, live forever. You know, some says he was aiming that toward Nebuchadnezzar, and yeah, he might have been, but I think he was talking to the Lord himself. Whoo, because he's going to live forever. Man, y'all all right? I ain't. I'm worried about the folks you're hanging around with, the demons around in your life that's holding you prisoner. And I know for everybody wants to be right, everybody wants to be whole. You know, if I could stand at the door and start giving out coupons to you, say, what's wrong with you? I got a bad ingrown toenail. Anybody had one of them? I'll give you a little pass. You go out the door and you'd be all right. I mean, I'd have them lined up from here to Hickox and probably to Nahunna, maybe even on to Brunswick if I could do those things. But I'm willing to show you how to get the gift of life through eternal life through Jesus Christ. Christ my Lord. People, am I telling you, there shouldn't be an empty pew in this house of lost people in this life? Can they not see that King of Kings is coming back soon? We can't get it right at the presidential side. We can't get it right on the legislative side. We can't get it right in our local government side. Our governors is just corrupt. And we can't get it right in our old sheriff department. We can't get it right in the house where mom and dad is not teaching their kids what thus saith the Lord. I'm telling you, my friend, it's a sign of the time in King Jesus is coming. Get ready. Get ready. And he said, there's nobody here, Jesus says, you ain't never met me. You ain't never had me. He says, this is the excuse part. This is what lost people do. They got an excuse. When we stand before the Lord, according to the word of God, we will stand without excuse. Have you ever just been flat caught doing something you shouldn't supposed to be doing? You know, I got caught speeding one time, probably 103 years ago, somewhere along there. And that man come up there and said, sir, do you know why I stopped you? Yeah. Sir, you know, yeah, I said, sir, I was speeding. I know why you're here. I know why the lights is on. I know why you kicked the donut around by air to come get me. I know. Guilty as charged. I said, just do whatever you got to do, sir. I said, I was wrong. Do you know the speed limit? Yes, sir, I do. I said, that sign back there not too far around that curve said 55 miles an hour, and I was doing 67. I understand that, sir. I'm guilty as charged. And that man that day, the last time I got pulled over, he said, sir, I understand that. He says, this is not a heavily trafficked road, but it does have rules and regulations on it. He says, but I'm going to let you go today. He says, you just promised me you'll slow down. Well, I did, all the way home, 54, 55 miles an hour. I've been back there a time or two, and I got reminded. I looked at my speedometer, and I'm around that same number again. And I back off of it. I said, you know what? I told that man I'd slow down, and here I am again. What am I going to tell him the next time? Well, I said all that to say this, because I'm guilty, you're guilty. When Jesus comes knocking on your heart door, you ought to say, I am guilty. There's none righteous, no, not one. There's none good, no, except the Lord. There's no way to heaven except by Him. My friend, I'm telling you, this guy, he says, I have no one here. He says, and by the, here's what your friends will do for you. He says, and by the time the waters move again, he says, I get in there, somebody else beats me to it. I'm going to make a statement. It's not a loaded question. But how many of you can agree that this is a dog-eat-dog world? Amen. Dog eat dog. I'm going to be first. I tell you an amazing thing at Brother Allen's sister Denise's 50th wedding anniversary. They asked me to say the blessing. And it was a preacher's perk. Of course, the you wouldn't call them newlyweds. What would you call them? Oldieweds? Maybe, I don't know. But anyway, however it fits right there. They got to eat first. And man, I sailed in there right behind them. I was number three. Man, I'm telling you, somebody come had the audacity to come out and says, yeah, how'd you make it up there to the front of the line? Yeah, had biscuits. Hey, what they don't know is sometimes the preacher likes to pick from the chicken and not get what nobody else wants. He wants to get something ahead of everybody else. But no, I was just standing there, and I looked at my wife. I said, I'm already up. I done said amen. Get in line. So we loaded up in line. But everybody else, nobody meant no harm. Now, don't get me wrong. But it's in us to want to be ahead of someone else. It's in us. Why? Because you think it's going to benefit you. These folks down there at the pool, they knew if they could beat this old 38-year-old guy that had this problem, if they could beat him into the pool, he wouldn't get salvation. He wouldn't get healed of his infirmity. Man, I'll tell you what, people will kick you side the head, throw you out the window, and make sure that they're first in line to the gas pump. And I'm here to tell you, and if there's one last biscuit on the plate, I'll go ahead and tell you, these Baptists will knock you down to get that baby. Well, I'm here to tell you, when Jesus comes into your life, my friend, there's a difference about you. The Bible says to how you know that you have Jesus Christ in your heart is that you have loved one for another. But that thing there where the man says, I didn't have nobody to help me, they're not going to help you. When it comes down to the nitty-gritty, mankind will not help you. If just listen, the first two boys born in this world, one was mad at the other and he killed his brother. He will not help you. I don't care how great a friend you got, when it comes to eternal things, they cannot help you. Grandma, grandpa's prayers cannot help you if you die unlearned. He said, I would, Lord, but every time I get ready, someone beats me in. That's no excuse. Not only that, he says, I wanted them to put me in the pool. Do you think if I had something real bad that I'd put you in front of me without the love of Christ in my heart? No way. I'd get in there first. He says, but while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Here's what Jesus says. Jesus said unto him, rise, take up thy bed and walk. And according to the word of God, immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked on the same day, which was the Sabbath. Now I got to come down here and get close with you. Something transpired. This man was a cripple. He ain't walked in 38 years, never in his whole life. And all of a sudden, the bed that he came, that usually they would tote these guys in on that bed and they'd stay. Jesus says, I'll tell you what I'll do. He says, there's a movement in there. I know you want to be healed. Jesus says, take up thy bed and walk. You know, if that guy had never actually tried to get up, he'd still be a cripple today. So you got to put forth some effort. Oh, I want him to save me. Well, you got to heed to the call. You got to heed to the unction of the Spirit of God that's pricking your heart. You got to understand that God's knocking at your heart door. You're feeling very uncomfortable at this moment. Something inside, I wish you'd hurry up and shut up so I could get out of here. Well, I'm not going to hush up, and I'm not going to shut up. And I'm just going to tell you, the gas is on, and I'm throwing it on the fire. I hope you realize that it is Jesus knocking at your heart's door, that if you want to spend eternity in heaven, you must be born again. So, brother, you're probably talking to mostly saved people. Well, if I were, I'd get a lot more amens. And ain't nobody going to say, oh, me, because then it means we're guilty. Well, let me go ahead and say it. Oh, me. Oh, me. Man, I love people. I don't, you know, it'd be a sad day for the Lord to position by me when Hickox Baptist Church gets raised up and I see some of these folks that I've seen in church many times and come by me and he go, oh, was that one of yours? I said, well, they come a lot, sir. Well, I'm afraid to tell you they ain't going to make it. Ain't nothing here, but on this date you told them, I sent the Spirit of God. They rejected it. Matter of fact, they rejected it so much when they got home, they went out and done more of the bad things like that so that it would ease the pressure of the Holy Spirit of God. You believe that happens? Oh, yeah. Yeah. If you don't believe that happens, have you ever been mad with the wife or something in your life and you get out in the driveway and you get out on the road and you just... And for the sake of killing yourself, you let off before you get to the bad curve. Well, that's what happens when the Spirit of God starts dealing on your heart. You'd rather mash the gas and go the wrong way into more trouble, to run as far away from it. Man, you can't outrun God. He's not just here in this building. He's out wherever you go. Jesus told this man, but the notation at the bottom, you got to remember this. Jesus told him, and it says, and this was on the Sabbath. Huh. You know what the bad thing is? Those Christian folks down there by the temple saw him going in. Those good people. Don't worry about those good people. Good people let you down. One of them walked up there and said, sir, what are you doing toting your bedroll? You don't tote your bed on the Sabbath day. And he said, well, I got news for you. The man that told me to get up and walk told me to take up my bed and walk. And I can walk again, and I'm toting my bed. Well, I'm here to tell you, my friend, there's something God might want you to tote. And it might not be feeling good. It might be somebody else's bed. It might be somebody else's problem. But you are a child of God. He may want you to do it in an inconvenient time. He might need you to show up and do something. This man, he did it. He put it in his arm. And you know, for two chapters, they sought to kill Jesus because of this. They sought to kill him. The word pride comes up a couple of times. And they all go back to that going crippled man. Shouldn't it be in a moment when somebody should have said, hallelujah, praise Jesus. I've been by there many years and that old Joe diary ain't been able to do nothing. And Jesus walked by. And them other folks, why didn't he heal all the other folks? It wasn't their day. The Bible says that Jesus died that so whosoever. But I believe under the sound of my voice, today's your day. I believe he's knocking at your heart door. I believe there's something that needs to be fixed. And he's kind of going to be like a wife. If you get married to him, every time you do something you're not supposed to, he's going to nag you. But he means it for good. He's going to remind you not to stop by the liquor store. He can remind you about them ugly words. He's going to remind you about those bills that you hadn't paid. He's going to remind you about the hate that you have with some family members. He's going to remind you of things that go on in your life that shouldn't be there. How you've not been faithful to your wife or your husband. He's going to remind you that. The reason why he does that, because he loves you, because he wants to make things right. And I'm just here to tell you, I'm sharing this message of love. He said, Brother Jamie, this don't sound like love at all. It ought to if you're right with God. God means business, and he wants to. And here's what worries me the most in my ministry, that I don't tell the whole truth. Because if I don't spread the whole truth and I leave the hurting parts out or the sharp edges out, what's going to happen to me when I stand before the Lord? He said, you had your chance, man. I gave you the words that would touch that one's life, and you chose not to use it. You chose a soft one. You hedged about the Word of God. You didn't tell them like it was. And now they're in hell, and their blood's on your hands. But I'm telling you, you ain't getting that from me. I'm cleaning my hands. I'm bad as Pilate. I leave here today, I'm going to the bathroom, wash my hands again. But really and truly, the best washing you can have is wash yourself in prayers with God and give it to him. Now, in this invitation, we got to that part finally, brother. I'm inviting you to obey the Lord, not obey me. Will you do it today? Will you do it this afternoon? I'm just telling you to do it. If you feel like that God's knocking on your heart, Brother Roy inspired me. I asked Brother Roy to end Vacation Bible School instead of me. Because that's kind of his folks, you know, young and different ones. He says, here's what I want to do. He says, I want to explain the plan of salvation. I said, go for it. It was perfect. Some of them, every mind that ever heard it, but they heard it Thursday night. Brother, that blood won't be on your hands. You did what God told you to do. You followed. You was obedient to what you said. Man, I sit back there and I'm going, I almost want to be saved again. For somebody. Today, listen, we're none promised tomorrow. Do something. Do something with it. You're never too old to start afresh and anew. I almost can say you're never too young to start afresh and anew if you got your mind right. Give it to Jesus. He can make a difference. Don't look at my life and say, well, it don't look like it's helping you out. You got all that. Listen, I may have ups and downs, but I'm up because Jesus is here. And when I'm down, he's there. Sweet is the walk when you're going through that deep grass and briars in the valley of your life. But all of a sudden you begin to feel the altitude change. You say, Lord, it feels like we're walking uphill. He said, keep praying. Victory's coming in the morning, whenever that is. And I know it is. And I know he will. Let's stand. Oh, our Father, help us. Help us today, God, that we will understand how precious it is that you would even look on us in all for eternal life. God, and I pray today that that one who's never did it would do it sometime. Your spirit may not always be this sweet and kind. And God, I pray we don't waste it. Help us to be obedient to your word and obedient to the Spirit of God. Bless us as only you can. In this song, we pray, Lord, you lift it up. And it'll make a difference. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing, brother.
Open up. Jesus, to reach out and touch Him and say that we love Him. Open our ears, Lord. Help us to listen. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus. That's all I ask, to be like Him. That's all I ask, to be like Him.
This is my buddy. I've picked at her for I don't know how many years, and she gave me that ugly look. I said, one day I'll get there. But you know what? Jesus beat me to it. Her mom and her granny come there and said that she accepted Jesus as her Savior. Phew. And you know what? First time in history, I was out here checking on the youth, Monday, whatever. It was about to get dark. And her and a friend of hers was walking by. And she come over there the first time in history. She had her arm out to hug me. Man. I knew something had changed. But I'd already known. I said, hey, Mom's got that taken care of. But here's the thing. Most important thing, she's born again. She had a special request. We're going to grant it. She wants her papa to baptize her. As soon as we get that arranged, we're going to let him. Old big brother Dave's going to get in our pool up there, and he's going to baptize his granddaughter. Man, what a joy. Amen. So I'm going to ask these two to go to the back door and let people slobber on you on the way back by, okay? Need a napkin? Some of these old folks, they got ugly stuff coming out of their mouth. Anyway, head on back there to the door. Love you, baby. I hope you have a blessed day. I hope God will just give you all the hugs and kisses you can imagine. Brother Jeff Johns, would you dismiss us, please?